Hello. Hi. Hi. I love you. Here is the episode you've been waiting for, the one I've been teasing you for since forever. And I wasn't going to do it, but I did it. And I love you. And I don't know how long I can keep sitting here and like thanking you for all of the messages and begging you to like write reviews and follow me on Instagram. God damn it. But I just want to give a really warm welcome to everyone who jumped over here from the Dopey podcast and anyone who jumped over here from any other podcast that I've ever been on. And I love you guys. Go back to the beginning. This is like a book. And I'm sorry if this is the first episode that you listen to be honest with you, because yikes. Okay, bye. Okay. Deep breaths in and out, deep breaths, nice and slow. We can do this. This is fine. You've done this before. This is good. You're fine. Okay. So I know it's like I sound like a broken record when I keep saying, I don't want to do this. I wake up every day with usually 10 or 15 things to do, and I accomplish maybe 3 or 4 of them because there's 7 to 9 that I just don't want to do. I almost canceled today. Like at 3 p.m. I was like, maybe I shouldn't go. Like I'm tired. I don't want to do this today. So I'm tired and I don't want to do this today. But I'm here. Hi. How are you? I missed you. I'm here and I'm going to do it. I'm going to do this today. To do it. Is that enough preamble? Hi. All right. Ugh. So, fuck. It's like, it's never just going to be like, you don't just jump off of a building. You know, you have a really bad day first. And I have to walk you through every step of this bad day. So at the end of it all, it'll make sense when I'm like, and then I jumped off a building. Like, you knew that this was coming. And I'm sorry it's taking me so long to get to it. Were you anxious? but I'm gonna walk you through step by step. And it's like, I'm in a good mood right now. I really like my life today in a sense, because there's a lot of things I don't like. But then maybe it's the coffee. I just feel, you know, I'm not like menstruating and I'm not about to menstruate. So I just like feel better than normal. And then I have to talk to you about one of, if not, you know, the worst day of my life. The most chaotic, crazy, fucked up, weird, awful day. And at the end of this day, I'm going to jump off a building. But it's only in my memory and in this like physical recording that I'm making now, but now it's going to be a part of your life too. So this will be the day that you listen to me tell you the story about the day that I jumped off a building. So okay, I love you. We're in it together. So look, this isn't going to be beautiful. I'll talk pretty next time. I just need to like walk you through it. I just need to step by step, one by one. I'm stalling. Fuck. Okay. So I was having a miscarriage. Okay, that's not funny, but that's like, I have some notes in front of me and that's my first one. So I was in the middle of a miscarriage and I was really sad. And I was living with this guy that I was engaged to, that I was also in an abusive relationship with. And my life was all fucked up, and I've only been out of prison for a couple of years, and I've really only been off of, wait, actually, oh, I forgot about all of this. So about like 3 weeks before this all happened, I got off of intensive drug probation. So I was in prison, and then I was on parole, and then I violated my parole, and then I was on intensive drug probation for 2 years. And now, this July of 2016, I get off. I made it all the way through. I faked every drug test for like 18 months. And I made it. I didn't violate. I didn't get arrested. I paid all my fines. I went to all my classes. I did everything that I had to do. I went to therapy. I moved in with this guy. I got a real job. I was like, I was doing everything that I was supposed to. I remember even the day that I got off, I had like a group chat with my family and we all texted and I was like, blah, 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 I'm off of probation. And I think like two people were like, yeah, good for you. And then my grandmother said something snarky like, and now you get to like do everything else you've been putting off for the last several years since you've been dealing with this. And I was like, okay, I love you. Gigi, I love you so much. And that was kind of a weird turning point because I think that when you reach those sort of precipices, you think that like, you're going to feel better. You're going to feel free. You're going to feel relieved. You're going to be like, yes, I fucking made it. Fuck you. You know, American like judicial system. And how I felt was really like I had nothing left to like tether me to the real world. That was like the one thing that I had to do. So I didn't go back to jail. And now I don't have anything to do other than like not commit any new crimes, which I'm pretty sure I was doing daily anyways. So it was like a weird transition from being constantly watched in an obsessive, like intensive drug probation way. And now I'm like, you know, just a candle in the wind. And then 3 weeks later, I had a miscarriage and I was living with this guy and he was being just as horrible as he always was. You know, he had told his sister that the only reason he was staying in Chicago was to like see about this Uber corporate job. And he had started, you know, texting with some new girl, some different girl in San Francisco named Jessica. So it's like we were just repeating this cycle, except now I was like, I was like free in a weird way, but I was also trapped. And going through that really intensive, like body, mind, physical miscarriage situation, you know, hey, that just puts you right on the edge of getting a phone call from your accountant telling you that $50,000 is missing from your bank account and you need to stop selling your stock that you've never sold. So all at once, just like one perfect bad day where I'm sad. I'm home from the hospital. I've got this person in my life who is the worst and nothing's changed. And then you get a phone call where you're just like, okay. You know, like it can't get any worse at this point. It can't get any worse until we have like our last fight, the last fight we're ever really going to have with each other, which was, you know, painful and awful and terrible. And I'll spare you all of the nitty gritty details of that last fight, but I'll just give you the quick little highlights. He said, I'm gay. Okay, shock. I never loved you. Like, also, again, shocking. and he was like, we were saying mean things to each other. You know, it was like a culmination of everything that we had both sort of put each other through for the last, you know, 5 years at this point. And he was like, I'm gay. I never loved you and you taste bad. And I was like, oh, ouch. I'm embarrassed that I just told you guys that. But like, that is the truth. Like, that's what really happened is like we had that fight and he said those three things to me. And I was like, and I'm going to kill myself. And it was just like a light switch went off in my head. And to be honest, I felt really relieved. You know, I was like, OK, that was exactly the combination of words that I needed to hear to take where I was in that time in my life and be like, all right, and lights out. So he was like, all right, I'm going to move out. And I was like, great. You know, I'm going to pack up my stuff for the evening and go stay in a hotel and you know, get the fuck out of my apartment. Really what I was going to do was go to a hotel and kill myself. But, you know, it's not like when you're really going to kill yourself, when you have that moment inside of yourself, like you don't really tell anyone, because if you tell someone, that sort of negates the whole like plan that you have laid out in your head. If you tell someone that you want to kill yourself, that's actually a really good sign that you don't actually want to kill yourself. You just have that feeling. And we should all become more comfortable being like, I want to kill myself. I want to kill myself. I want to kill myself. If you feel that way in any moment, so that, you know, if you ever really, really want to kill yourself, maybe you say it out loud and then, you know, something gets in your way. But I didn't say anything. I just went on hotels.com, sponsor us, and booked a room at the Congress, and I packed a small bag and then I left. I made a couple of stops on my way. An old trope we are all familiar with. I got a bunch of benzos and I got them in a really fucking fucked up and dishonest way. I knew that my neighbor was prescribed some kind of like generic Klonopin. I knew that he didn't take it very often. I knew that he had a bunch of half empty pill bottles on his back porch and various bags because we were close and we lived next door to each other for 3 years. So I went through our back porches up to his porch. I went through all of his bags. I found every benzo that he had, which ended up being like 32 clozapams, which is basically Klonopin. And I went to a CVS and I bought some straight razors. And then I went to a bodega and I got some alcohol and I was like, all right, this is like your like suicide fun pack, you know? I was familiar with this and I was like, I'm going to this hotel. I'm like, no one is gonna fucking get me in the bathtub this time, you know? So I decided to have like a final stroll, I guess. I put on my favorite pair of shorts. It's like the end of July. I'm downtown in like the heart of Chicago. The Congress is right across the street from Grant Park and the Art Institute. And I have some weed and I take a joint and I walk around for about 3 hours and I smoke on a bridge and I just like say goodbye to like everyone in my head and in my heart. And I just think and think and think about my life and what I'm doing. And I think about my dad and I think about my mom and I think about my whole family. And I am not returning any text messages. And I'm just, you know, I'm just preparing myself for what I know is coming, for something that I'm very familiar with, for something that I'm aching and like yearning to do and have been since I was 10 years old. So it's like, this is like my wedding day, basically, is how I'm preparing and feeling about this whole experience. I'm not sad. I'm relieved. So I go back to the hotel, swallow all the benzos, drink like 2 hard ciders. That's what I bought. I'm a pussy. Leave me alone. And then I do the same thing. I like get in the tub. I try to cut my wrists. Still can't really get the courage to go as hard as I need to. Make some, you know, gashes, but nothing serious enough to like bleed me out, you know? And then I fell asleep at like 8 p.m. It was really like really, really lackluster, you know, just not that exciting, not that crazy, not that manic, or, you know, like I'm not like breaking shit. I'm not doing anything too psycho yet. Not yet. And then I woke up. I woke up the next day like it was nothing. I like fell asleep like normal and then woke up like normal. And I was like, wow, like all of those benzos were expired and none of that worked. And I had taken 32 like half milligrams. So that means I had had 16 milligrams of benzodiazepam. Like I should have at least slept for like 30 hours on that. I should have at least slept for more than like a, you know, average-ish night of sleep. So So we'll get to that later. So then I get in a cab and I go back home and I think that he's going to be gone. And, you know, I don't know what to do at this point. I'm feeling kind of like numb and lost and weird. I haven't given up the suicide attempt. I've just thought, all right, that was like, that was what you always do. And you're going to have to really like gear up, you know, for whatever's next. And I'm honestly thinking in my head, I'm like, where can I get a gun? That's what I wanted to know. And I was trying to figure out which friends I could text in a way that was not so scary. Like, how could I manipulate someone who already had a gun into letting me see and or use their gun? I wasn't really sure what I was going to do, but I was really thinking, like, I need to get a gun. And I get back to my apartment, and then he's still there. He's, like, moving out the last of his stuff. And I just immediately start crying. I sort of like lose my nerve, you know, where the night before I was like, okay, get the fuck out, you know, and we had this fight and it was over, right? But then I see him again and he's moving his stuff out and I'm just like, ah, like I'm a little kid and I'm like chasing my mom's car down the driveway, you know, like begging her not to stay. It's like that moment all over again. And I'm like crying and I'm like, no, don't go. I, you know, changed my mind. I'm like, it's fine. You can have the money. I don't care. Like, I don't care if you're gay. Like, what am I saying? Like, what am I doing? But that's what I was, that's where I was in that moment. I'm like, I don't care that you're gay. I don't care that you stole 50 grand from me. Like, I don't care. I'm like, I cannot live without you, because I thought at that point in time that I'm like, I need to be in this abusive situation, even though I literally wanted to die. So he's like, no, I really am leaving this time, and like it really is over, and like I don't need you anymore, and like I fucking hate you. And I was like, okay, cool. Cool, cool, cool. Then I set some of his clothes on fire. I don't know, it's kind of hazy because I did actually start to black out at this point. So the effects of expired benzodiazepam is a delayed reaction. So that full 16 milligrams of Klonopin hit me at like 11:30 the next day. And I took them at like, you know, 6, 7 p.m. the night before. So it was a like weird thing to have slept fully a night and then wake up and then several, it was almost like being drugged, you know, that I drugged myself. But the drugs kicked in right around that time, and that's sort of when I lose my full, like, clear recollection. Everything else that I remember is just pieces, just little tiny puzzle pieces of an entire night. So it's like 11:30 a.m. I jumped at 5:41 a.m. the next day. So almost 24 hours later, I am fully blacked out, except for these tiny little puzzle pieces that I'm going to try and put together for you now. So we get in this fight. I beg him to stay. He says no. I set his clothes on fire in our bedroom. So fun, cool, definitely graceful at breaking up. And he like leaves in a hurry, I guess, whatever, baby. And then I was like, okay, I'm gonna, that was the moment where I was like, all right, I'm gonna go to the roof and jump off. That, like, I was like, that's the plan. So another joint, a pack of cigarettes, up to the roof. As I'm going up, I see my neighbor, not the one I stole the pills from, another neighbor of mine named Scott. Beautiful, lovely, gorgeous human being. And he's like with a girl and he's got a guitar and he had been like serenading her on the roof. Like, how cute, you know? And I'm like going up there almost halfway blacked out, tears streaming down my face. I just like set a small fire in my apartment and I'm going to jump off. And I know that. And I like see him and he was like, made very intense eye contact with me. And he's like, are you okay? Like, are you good? And I was like, yeah, I'm fine. I just need to like be alone. If you could just let everyone else know that that I'm up here and I don't want any company. So my neighbors and I, we had all thrown in $20 like 2 years ago and gotten a ladder to this little hatch up to the roof of our apartment. And we weren't supposed to go up there, but it was like the dopest place to hang out. And we had put blankets and pillows and, you know, there was like a Home Depot next to us. So we had a projector that we would watch movies on. And it was like our little spot, you know? And I was up there alone from 11:30 a.m. on a Monday until 5:41 a.m. on a Tuesday. So I was blacked out, and I know that there's one thing that I did for sure, because I have a digital footprint to track exactly how long and how many times I did this. But I was blacked out, and I did something really fucked up. And I don't know if like your blackout self is your real self, or your blackout self is like your evil self, or your blackout self is like your repressed self, or your blackout self is, you know, the person that you're always trying to like hide from and keep at bay. But in my blackout self, I took a video of him that I had blowing some dude, and I sent it to every single person that we knew mutually. So like his friends from college, his friends on Facebook, his family, his ex-girlfriends. I mean, like literally everyone, like girls that he hooked up with, like girls that he cheated on me with, like the British girl. I sent a video of him blowing some guy to every single person that he knew, which is undoubtedly cruel and completely the wrong thing to do. And I mean, you can unsubscribe from this podcast right now if you hate me for that, but I stand by it. So I did that because I stand by it, because I did it, you know, I did it. I sent it to everyone that he knew, including his mother, who I don't think ever saw it because I don't think she has Facebook Messenger installed on her phone. Thank glob. So I do that all night. I'm like sending videos left and right, revenge porn, like horrible. Am I like legally liable for admitting that? For doing that? Okay. I did it. I really did do it. So I sent everyone that video. And then I made a bunch of phone calls to like numbers that I don't recognize. Just a bunch of, I don't know, they were like in my area code, but I don't know whose numbers they were. And I had a phone conversation for 3 minutes and 48 seconds at 5:35 a.m. And then I got off that phone call, whoever I was talking to. And then I jumped. And then at 5:41 a.m. on Tuesday, July 28th, 2016, I jumped off a 5-story building while I was semi-blackout on Klonopin. And a couple of things happened when I jumped. A couple of like perfect things happened when I jumped, because you know the end. I mean, like I made it. Like I died for 19 seconds, but I did survive somehow. So perfect storm. Hey, perfect storm. At 5:41 a.m., there was a jogger running down my street who saw me jump from my building and ran up to me, had his phone on him, called 911. And so it was like there was someone there right when it happened, watched it happen. There was a firehouse. Is that what you call it? Where firefighters live? A firehouse right across the street from where I lived, like literally across the street. There were trained paramedics. So he called. They were right across the street. And then the hospital that I went to, which was like a level 3 trauma hospital where they treat like gunshot wounds and stuff, was less than a half mile away from where I jumped. So perfect timing, really. That's a comedy joke. Perfect timing. The jogger was there. The firemen were across the street. And I had taken all of these benzos. So even though I jumped and did like a full, like arms open wide swan dive, like face first off the edge of my building, even though I did that, I was on so much Klonopin and I was so blackout that my body went completely limp, meaning I didn't tense up at all when I fell. So I didn't break my neck. I didn't break my back. I didn't break all of the important bones down like the center of my spine up until my hips. My hips got really fucked up. But I didn't break any of those like that would have instantly paralyzed or killed me because I was so relaxed. Funny. Isn't that funny? That's really funny to me. So I fucking did it, you know, in a weird way. I'm like almost proud of myself because I had been trying to kill myself my whole life. And then I finally fucking did it. But I do regret it. And I hate that I have to say that just because I know that that's sort of like the common trope with suicide. And it just bothers me that I regret it so much. And I probably wouldn't regret it so much if I hadn't sustained such serious injuries that will now affect me for the rest of my life and keep me in a constant state of like agony and pain. So I regret that because up until this point, I was like a pretty lucky kid. Like I chipped my tooth when I was 10 and I never broke a bone my entire life. You know, I never had any serious illnesses or injuries like ear infection, like tonsillitis, like bad flus, like ODs on purpose, you know, but like I never got hurt before. I had never really been injured in the way that you injure yourself when you jump off a fucking building. So this next episode, I'm going to tell you about what it's like to die, but I have to finish the story and just let you know how I died. So I fucking died. I died. I died for 19 seconds. And that I'm also proud of because like, okay. I mean, did you die? Like, no. But no, don't die. I love you. I need you here. Actually, we like have to do this together. Otherwise it doesn't work. So, but I did die. I bled out. I broke 13 bones. I shattered my elbow, did like a face plant into the pavement. My entire pelvis was, you know, decimated. My pelvic bones punctured my bladder. So my bladder was also super fucked up. And my lung collapsed. My right lung collapsed. And broke my arm, all over my arm. And you heard elbow. And broke my leg and my ankle and like my femur, like all the way up, you know, to my knee. And I lived because I was incredibly lucky and it was like a perfect combination of things, of the jogger, of the fireman, of the Klonopin, of the hospital, and just having all of those together, you know, gave me an opportunity to like take my life back because I don't think I really wanted to die. I think I wanted to kill a part of myself that never died, you know, and it was the part of me that was always searching for love in the wrong places. It was the part of me that, you know, couldn't get out in an abusive relationship. It was the part of me that like hadn't healed from my lifetime of like generational trauma, you know. It was the part of me that felt, you know, completely alone and sad because I was alone, because being disconnected is the worst you can feel, and that's why people use drugs and kill themselves. So I wanted to kill all of those parts of me, and I did effectively for 19 seconds. I bled out. When you bleed out, that's like a tough way to go, because then your heart stops working, so they have to like get blood into you really fast and then restart your heart, which lucky enough, who knew I was fucking O positive blood type, meaning that I was like capable of accepting any type of blood. So normally in those situations, like, you could wait for a period of time where you don't get the right blood if you have a rare blood type that can accept any type of blood. But I was so lucky. All of those things, just so fucking lucky. And my heart stopped. I bled out. They had to intubate me and then do one of those little, what are those machines called? Defibrillator? Yeah, thank you. Had to do the defibrillator. And when I died, I was gone for forever, as far as I'm concerned. I'm still there sometimes. But it was only 19 seconds. So I didn't have any serious brain damage. And, like, they didn't know at first how I was going to do after all of that. But I mean, I'm relatively fine. You know, I'm like alive. I have all of my limbs, more or less. And I guess I'll just tell you what it was like to die next time. Can't wait. How long was that? Oh, perfect. Okay.